Hello, Jim Howard here in Fort Worth, Texas. Today's date, it is September 10th of 2017, and Hurricane Irma is just a couple hours ago, I think it hit Key West, Florida, and it's heading inland. This is going to be a blog. Instead of having to type it out, I'm just going to. And a lot of my videos are that way. And so if you don't like these rambling things where I talk about a bunch of different things, if you're looking for one specific topic, you might want to avoid this video. First off, well, by the time you see this video, things should be corrected, but I've been using WordPress to do my blogs for a long time. I've used different hosting companies, you know, because I've been doing it for years. Before it was WordPress, it was Jumbalaya or whatever. That's the only time I've been ever hacked. I got hacked twice when I was running that software. There's people who like that kind of software, and it's similar to WordPress software in the coding and what have you, but that software, there are people out there who just are using the software or fascinated with it, and they're looking for every little thing they can do to play around and mess things up. So that's the only software. And two, they I don't remember the one time, but the one time they never really could do anything, except they did this one time when my blog started up, it said hacked by, and you know, the hacker's name or whatever, and that was it. So I had to go in and delete that, do something or other. But that software, I just got hit like that a couple times, but other people were getting hit a lot, and it's just sort of like the chatting program. What is that? I don't want to say FTP. Where you go to these chat rooms, which was really popular, really helpful too. And before there was a World Wide Web on the internet, those places were really. But there's people, and they're looking for the opportunity. When somebody new goes, if somebody that's not really experienced with it goes in, IRC, that's it, IRC. There's just constant hacking going on, trying to people be, some of it sophisticated, most of it not. Some of it just, they send something that looks like you think, you know, that you have to enter your password or do something, then they have your username, your password, and so anyway, I've gone from hosting company to hosting company, and the most recent one, I have three right now, I believe, hosting companies, but I think one of them just is holding a bunch of my domain names, and the other one I think doesn't have anything on it now. I really just need to cancel it. But with WordPress, let's see, there's WordPress, is it .com or .org? I can't remember. Okay, it's up there, WordPress.com. You can go to WordPress.com, and They will host everything for you. Now you pay them. They kind of get you for, you know, you sign up for it and it's, what is it, $13 a month. Well, you have to pay for everything in a year in advance. But it's $13, but then a month, but then you have to pay. No, you get a free domain name of your choice. But they sort of just keep hitting you for a while until you, so you might as well decide you're going to be spending with them 30 a month or whatever, because of, and then two, you know, they have a, well, unless you do the 30 a month, then you get unlimited data storage, etc. But so you can get hosting it on your own, you know, signing up with a hosting company and doing it there on your own, which is easy to do, because the hosting company will, there'll be a menu that'll say set up a WordPress site, plus there'll be other things you could set up, and you click, it gets installed, there it is. But now with WordPress.com, they're doing everything at their end. But then there's some, you kind of put, there's little restrictions. If you've been using, like I have for years, there's some things you really can't do. I'm not sure if you pay $30 a month, I think maybe most of those things would be turned on for you. Well, anyway, I signed up a year or two ago for paying about $30 a month to a hosting company. And I got, for the first time in the past, I paid like $1.50 a month for a hosting company, or $9 a month, or $13 a month. And I signed up for $30 a month, and because of deluxe plan, and I forget all the extras that they were giving me. Not buffering, what do you call it? Caching. All kinds of things. And so when they installed it, it was kind of, something was kind of wrong when they installed it. But I made do with it. And then recently, because of, well, they upgraded me, that was it. I got upgraded. And they gave me caching program and a couple other things. And all of a sudden, I started having trouble. I couldn't change things. Apparently, the caching, I had to turn the caching off. That didn't work. And it just got to be such a mess. So I went and tried to fix it and ended up messing it up. And I could have gone in and corrected it, and I just decided, no, I'm just going to go with WordPress.com and let them handle everything at their end. And so I just did that. So if you are using my Apple app, does not work, hasn't worked for a while. I have no idea how to change it, how to fix it, because I paid a guy to set that up, the Apple app, and he did it with his site or account, I guess, with Apple. And he's not in business anymore. So that has been working for a while. Now the Android app works. Well, it doesn't. Doesn't work since this morning. Let's see if it's back up yet. On the cell phone, it's not up, but it is up finally after a few hours. So if you go to showmeblog.com, it's up. See if I back out of here and try it again. Still not up on the on the Android app. So it'll be up in probably fairly quickly. So it's up, and I've been trying to. There's some things that I can't do that I could normally do with it. So, but I'm working with it. So let's stop talking about that. Let me close that down. Close, or did it? No, I think I wanted to leave this up for a second. Here's the WordPress.com thing that if you have an account that you go to and you can change the things around. Again, I'm jumping around here. The Republicans are enraged now in Congress at Donald Trump because he made a deal with the Democrats, and that what for 3 months or something or other, in 3 months that then they would take care of the debt limit and take care of the some other things, and the Republicans in Congress wanted to force the tax cut for the rich or do other things by threatening that they wouldn't approve the credit limit increase or whatever like that. And so Trump, with the Democrats, they just put that off and then they can work on these other things like the which the Republicans wanted to hold like hostage. Okay, the debt increase has to be, or the United States would become insolvent, wouldn't be able to pay its bills. And so, but Trump went ahead and made a deal with the Democrats. Let's just put that off and take care of, funding for Harvey and the other natural disasters and take care of other things. So the Republicans are really in Congress now, are finally pissed at Trump. But so as part of the deal that was made the other day, Congress went ahead and passed the first, or maybe it's not the first, maybe they did one the other day too, but they approved $15 billion in support for those people in Texas that were impacted by Hurricane Harvey. And both Republican senators here voted for it. And in the Senate, it passed by 80 to 17. In the House, 316 voted yes on this. 90 voted no. Four Republicans voted no. Four Texas Republicans, House members voted no. Because the four members, none of them by the way, they represented the areas that was impacted by the hurricane. But they voted against the relief program to help the hurricane victims because they are against raising the public debt ceiling without a plan to reduce deficits in the short term. So, Republicans, what the Republicans actually want to do is they want to cut taxes. That's the one thing they want to do. They want to cut taxes for the wealthy. Now, of course, they're going to say, it's tax relief for the middle class. It's not. Republicans supposedly are, will be officially, fiscally, but with money, they're supposed to be conservative and want to keep it under control, but they actually don't. They want tax cuts for their. Bill Clinton, President Clinton, actually handed over to Bush when Bush took office. Clinton had a surplus. We had a surplus of money. And of course he did that. He got that surplus by also Republican Congress working with him. And so he turned over a surplus to President Bush when he took over, and President Bush and his people immediately gave massive tax cuts to the wealthy, and then immediately the United States had majored, and all the entire 8 years that Bush was in office, we ended up with massive, you know, deficit. And the reason was that tax cut. And Republicans now want to do the same. They want to also take out money from Obamacare and give, they want to take that money out, which will cause a collapse and will cause all kinds of trouble with health care and hospitals and doctors and all types of stuff. And they want to take that money and give that to the wealthy. And the idea is, and the Republicans have this propaganda that they put out, that tax cuts to the wealthy, it will trickle down, it creates jobs, and does it. It never has. Zero. There is no history of it. They'll mention Reagan or something like that. No. It's never happened. Never going to happen. Won't happen. Didn't happen. Never. When you might think, oh, okay, well, if you cut the taxes on rich Mr. McScrooge Duck or whatever, he's going to go out and start a business. He's going to start a factory. He's going to hire more employees. He's going to, no, it doesn't work that way. Doesn't happen. Never did. Never will. So that's what this is all about. I wanted to mention this for some reason. I don't know why it popped in my mind. I worked the 2000 census in Missouri, and that really made me, I've mentioned this before, it really made me feel good about the United States, the American people, and our system. All the people that I contacted, except for one, everybody I contacted was really nice. Now, there was a few, other than this one, of course, I'll get to him. There was a few people that said, I don't think I want to, and I said, well, just let me start, and if there's a question you don't want to answer, you know, we'll talk about it. Just started for some reason, you know, and they went ahead and they did the census. But there was one guy who went to the door. I'm not going to, you know, get off my property, you know, don't you dare come on my property, get out of here. And of course, I was actually going to, try to help the guy, but I couldn't, he wouldn't, you know, let me, I said, well, sir, let me, get off, don't you come to my property. Government's not going to get information from me. You don't have any right to, you know. And I was, oh, sir, now, if, and he, I, that's all I could get out was that. I wasn't even going to explain to him, because I knew that wouldn't do any good. The type of person that I'm sure he was, you know, well, the government has no right to do that. You can't ask me those questions or whatever. There are very few things. Our founding fathers wrote a fantastic, you know, Declaration of Independence, and they wrote a fantastic Constitution. There isn't very much in the Constitution, but they covered all the bases. I think now it actually needs, after all these years, we actually need, and because of things that have changed. I do think we need to go in and make some changes to it. A few years ago, I would have said, no, let's not change it. But I think now it does need to be changed. But anyway, I was going to explain to this guy that one of the few things in the Constitution of the United States is that there will, every 10 years, be taken a census, and they spell out in there, you know, that, I forget how they put it, but it will be a, you know, you're not going to send out a letter, it's going to be one-on-one. Somebody is going to go out, talk to everybody. Of course, more than one person, but, you know, you're going to go out and do it that way. Because before the 10,000 or the 2,000 census, a lot of Democrats, because of the cost and everything of it, they wanted it to be done more. They wanted to do some of it that if they could, they wanted to do it by statistical, you know, sampling. And, of course, the Republicans, no, the Constitution, it says, you know, which it does. That it, I forget, one of, you know, it spells out that you got to go out and do it. Not that you can sit back in an office someplace. And, of course, we have computers now, and this statistical information really is, that you get for things is really... turns out to be accurate. So anyway, the 2000 census, the 2000 census was done the way our founding fathers would have wanted, except our founding fathers didn't know that, you know, that we were going to have more than 13 colonies, and didn't know that we were going to have, the population in 1790 was 3 million people. And the census in 2000 was almost 3 million people. So, anyway, I went out and did the census. And, what I was going to tell this guy, or try to, I wasn't going to mention that one of the few things in the Constitution of the United States is that a census has to be done. And what I was not going to mention was that actually, legally, you do have to give the information to the government, because his head would have exploded. And also, even the government, whether it's Democrat or Republican, whether it doesn't matter what administration is in or whatever, you know, there was in 2000 almost 300 million people, and I don't think anybody was ever, well, in Texas there was a lawyer who lived in a, you know, very nice house. I think it had a wall. I saw some video, I think, of it. You may have seen it, too, because it made the news. But, you know, she had a iron gate or something at the entrance to her property, and a big old wall around her property. And I guess maybe I think she might have an intercom or whatever. But a census person came. You know, I didn't climb the wall. Didn't go over the gate, didn't pick the lock, and he was outside. And I guess she came, well, she had to come out because she shot him. So she came out and told him, you know, get the hell out of here, don't you come back, and she shot him. So there were a few cases of census workers being assaulted. But definitely the government didn't want any, they didn't want any citizen to get into trouble. So what I was going to tell the guy was, well, sir, here's what's going to happen. Listen, let me explain, you know, because he wouldn't. Let me explain to you what's going to happen. When I report back that, you know, that you wouldn't cooperate and give any information or whatever, they're going to send out another person thinking that this other person can just, you know, get the information. Maybe I just didn't know how to do it, or wasn't diplomatic enough, or whatever. They'll send another person out. You're going to refuse to cooperate with that, you know, with that person. Of course, the truth might be, which I wouldn't tell him, is, you know, the other worker comes out and he's not there, and his wife maybe gives the information. But so then that person goes back, couldn't get the information. So they send out a supervisor to get the information. The supervisor can't get the information. I don't know if they'd send out another supervisor or not. So then what happens is they send out a census taker who goes to your next door neighbors. Now, God, that 2000 is when we had a short form and a long form. And the long form, oh man, you had to ask a whole bunch of questions. And I don't know if this, I can't remember now if this guy was one who was, I think of like 1 out of 7 or 1 out of 10 or maybe 1 out of 15. They'd had to do a long, you know, the long form. And so what would happen is they send out the person, they go to your next door neighbor. Now, of course, it would depend on the, if it was a short form, it would be, you know, okay, how many people live there? It would be very few questions, you know, that they could get if it was a long form. Which was, I believe it, you know, do they have a toilet? Do they have a telephone? A whole bunch of questions like that. And they would go to the, you know, next door neighbors. If they got the information that they needed, you know, then they, but if they didn't, they'd go to people across the street or whatever and try to get the information that they could, because they were required by law to. By the way, those questions, they did away in 2010. With the long form. But I remember before the 2000 census watching C-SPAN, and the head of, and other people too with it that belonged to the, what is the bureau? I can't remember. I should remember. They paid me. Census Department, or Department of Commerce. They had to appear before the House and the Senate committees, and the committee members went over, okay, this question here, why are you asking this question here? And the, you know, people would say, well, that question is there because Congress passed a law regarding veterans that they had to know how many people, you know, and it was everything. So when he got all done, the Democrats and Republicans, oh, okay, yeah, all that information needs to be asked. So in 2000, we had almost 300 million people. The census cost $4.5 billion, which is an average cost per person of $16. I wish I could have done the 2010 census, but I was in Florida, did not have a car. But anyway, because I felt so good when I went out and talked to these people, and it was in a rural area, redneck area in Missouri, conservative. It shouldn't have been conservative, it should have been liberal, but conservative. And I went to houses that, you know, white people that had adopted a black child or a handicapped child or a child from a foreign country, and just, you know, it, not just white families, but I really felt good about the United States and the way things were going until the recent elections. But The 2010 census, there was 308 million people, and it cost, instead of $4.5 billion, it cost $13 billion. And instead of costing $16 per person, it cost $42 per person. And I knew a guy who worked the 2010 census, and every census worker, like when I did it in 2000, it was paperwork. You know, we had maps, and we had a, you know, list, and then we had the forms to fill out. The 2010 census, they had apparently, I think, specially designed devices, like smaller than a, more like a palm device, I think, from the way this friend described it, but specially designed. It wasn't something that they just ran a, you know, an application on, and they used that for GPS, for, you know, all that type of stuff, and then for putting the input that in data and doing all that was done. And he said that, and I don't know how many census workers there were, but believe me, there is a lot, because you have to cover the entire United States, every part of it. And of course, all those devices would be surplus. There would be no use. You know, they're not going to save them for 2020. They probably got dumped in a dump, you know, trash dumpster someplace. That's probably the reason for the expense. Probably made, by the way, too, which I didn't know, because they didn't tell us that, when, by the way, the census is super confidential. You just couldn't give out any information at all. If you know you're out in an area and the police come up there, sure, you can tell them, I'm a census, you know, I'm a census worker, you know, here's my ID, I'm doing the 2000 census, or the 2010, whatever you're doing. You know, if the police said, you know, maybe they should know, but maybe the police officer, I don't know, this person looks suspicious. You know, if they would say, okay, well, let me see your papers that, you know, well, no way. You can't see the list or whatever. Okay, well, I know my route, my patrol area here, and you just came from that house there. I know who lives there. What's the name of the person that lives there? You can't tell them anything like that. I had a point for going into that area, and I can't remember now what it was. So let me close it. Oh, no, that's, well, okay. I do think that we should, well, back in 2000, like I said, a lot of the Democrats wanted to go to statistical, getting information that way. And Republicans didn't, because the Constitution. And they were right. It's written in the Constitution. I think we should change the Constitution and do it. Because the Republicans thing, well, they thought it's a plot. Because the Republicans, the way they operate is, you know, what would they do, you know? If they, you know, if they could do it, they would fix it where, you know, minorities wouldn't be represented as much or whatever. Just, so the Republicans naturally think the Democrats would do that, which they wouldn't. That's one reason, plus, you know, the Republicans, so the only way you could would be for the Constitution to be altered, and if you're going to make a little change there, We ought to make a few other little changes in, the Constitution. No, I'm not talking about doing away with the Second Amendment. But we do need some changes. Let's see. I also enjoy doing the census work because you picked your, you had to go to certain areas, because you had maps and you had, and but I mean, you could do it. You could pick the time. You could do it in the morning. Of course, you sort of need to do, a lot of people work and you have to do it when they're home, But you could pick your hours. And then, too, you got paid for when you were at home on your own time, when you were at home and checking the paperwork to make sure you had everything done and making your list to where you're going to go, tomorrow and getting all your forms together and all that kind of stuff. You could mark that down and then you mark down your mileage and you got paid for that. That was kind of, I like the idea of that. Oh, yeah, what I was going to say, what I did not know is I went out and I would do the census and I'd say, okay, well, you're safe for 10 years. One guy was like 100 years old. I mean, really, he was, he lived on a farm. I pulled in there and he was out there on his tractor or whatever, stopped his tractor, got off, came on over, and, turned out he was 100 years old. So anyway, when I got all done, I said, "Okay, well, I'll see you in 2010." He says, "Youngster, I'm 100 years old. I won't be alive then." I said, "No, I'm sure you will be. You look healthy, and I'm going to come back in 2010, and we're going to do the census again." And he, "Youngster, And what? And then too, okay, these people, I do the census. Okay, you're all done till 10 years from now. What I did not know is, and there again, the census people, because I went to a few people and they said, later on, went to a few people. You guys already came out and did the census. I said, well, you're on my list, so we did it again. God, I hope those weren't people that had the long form. But they went ahead and did it again. What I found out later is, yes, I didn't know that. They, Census Bureau, to make sure the information is correct, they, I don't know, 1 out of 7, 1 out of 10, 1 out of, it wasn't very many. They would have, after, say, I turned in my paperwork, another census worker would come out to the very same, and I'm out here to do the, do the census, and they'd say what was already done, and I guess that person would have known, and would said, well, what we do is we check to on to make sure we're getting accurate information, and so they didn't just say, hey, census worker was out here, Jim Howard, of course they wouldn't have said, Jim Howard is out here on such and such a date, and the people could say, oh yeah, he was, yeah, real nice guy, They they went through the entire form again. They did the complete thing over again to see if there was any discrepancy. Now, right away when we first started the census, the word came out that there was a lady in town in Kansas City. That was just they found out real quick, and I guess that's how they found out. She never left her apartment apparently, and just filled out the filled out the information. So they were doing that, and then honestly. They checked again out of, so say I went out and do all these census, say I, how many ever I did, there'd be people come out and check on what I had done, and they would fill out a form and turn it back. And then out of those number, which would be a smaller number, they would come in and they would send out somebody else to check on those people. Oh my God. No wonder the cost was what? 15 billion or whatever it was to do it. But that's how they wanted to make sure that it was, you know, accurate. So let's listen, see what's going on, if we probably won't hear anything. The amateur radio hurricane watch net. Okay, we don't want to listen to that very long, do we? Here's my new, well, it looks like it looked the same to you, but this is my new blog. I'm back using, by the way, the old name for, oh God, you know. Let me check and see if it's live on here yet. Be sure to get my Android app. It's in the Android store, by the way. Nope, still not there. But the Apple one, I don't know. It's not going to work. It hasn't worked. I don't even know how to get it out of the... Because I didn't put it in. I don't even know how to get it out of the system. And I had somebody do the Android app, but I put it into my Android, whatever the account was. I put it in there, and I have the files, and I could edit them, and hang on a second. Ouch. Don't touch that. Don't touch the mouse, I'm coming back. I actually haven't really looked at the book yet. I mean, I flipped through the pages. But this tells you how to make your own Android. It looks difficult, but tells you how to make your own Android apps. If there's somebody out there that's smart, I got this on clearance someplace for $3.09. Well, I'm not sure. Wait a minute. $3, I guess. Yeah, there's the code at the top says 03/09/16. I guess that's the date. Half price books. Android application development all in one for dummies. Android Jumpstart, Android background material, the building blocks, programming cool phone features by Barry Bird, not Bird, B-U-R-D. Let's see. Go to Amazon here. You know, if you're smart, and probably an awful lot of young guys are, and women, I gotta say, I guess, Amazon, you could just get a book. Maybe this is not the latest book. Let's see. Maybe I should just do, maybe just a name would work. Yeah. Let's see, Beginner's Programming with Java for Dummies, $25. Java Programming for Android Developers for Dummies. Beginning Program for Java for Dummies. Java for Dummies. I got a feeling apps must be written in Java. Android application. Okay, this is it. $25. Android application development, all in one for dummies. That's it. $25 on Amazon. I'll try to remember to put the link below and give it. Eclipse for dummies. I don't know what Eclipse is. Java for dummies. Well, wait a minute. Maybe this isn't it. Maybe this is a different one. See this one. It's this one here. Anyway, you know, you could probably make some money, work from home, have an excuse to buy a better computer and do all kinds of stuff. I actually heard that it is actually not hard to do. It looks hard to me. Oh, I'm getting ready to go to CNN here. I'm not even good because it would get me going. Did you follow the story about the nurse that got... Well, the police officer went there and insisted that blood be drawn from the guy, and the nurse explained to him, even showed him. He was a detective. Showed him the policy, which had been approved also by the police department, that in order to draw blood, the person either had to give his consent, or the person had to be under arrest, give consent, or a court order. And the detective, after a little bit, said, "I'm tired of, you know, messing with you," or whatever, and grabbed her and put handcuffs on her and put her out in his patrol car for 20 minutes. And two, he said, somebody quoted him. He also said that he was going to screw that hospital. He was going to bring him every slime bag person who didn't have any insurance, and he was going to take all the people that had insurance to a different hospital, and that he was that when they report said that he was an ambulance driver, and I thought, no, he's not an ambulance driver. Probably an EMT. He may be a paramedic. Anyway, he got fired from the police department, which he should be. And two, the statement that he made. Anyway, he worked for like 31 years part-time for an ambulance service, and they fired him. But I don't want to get started on that story, because I spent 30 years working hospital security, so I would just get upset. By the way, I just happened to see... I try to forget the name of this hospital down in Florida. It's a for-profit hospital. I think it's Health Corporate. Well, they changed their name. They committed so many frauds, so many felonies, that they changed, I think, the name. Well, I don't think they changed the name of the hospital, but the health corporation that owned them has changed their names. And Rick Perry, who is now governor of Florida, he was the head of the corporation. And he's now governor of Florida. But so this is, I spent 30 years in the Kansas City area and never worked for I worked for a bunch of different hospitals. St. Joseph Hospital, Trinity Lutheran Hospital, Research Medical Center, Research Belton Hospital, Menorah Medical Center, Lee Summit Hospital. Now, some of those were under our corporation, so don't want to make you think that I, man, got fired from all those places. I only got fired from one of them, and that was actually because the director of security, who I kind of liked, actually, he was really, really racist. And we clashed a few times over that. And finally, he wasn't supposed to fire me, but he lost his temper and he fired me. And which I was, I couldn't take him anymore, actually. I was happy to go. But not many, well, I'm sure during the 60s, I'm sure there were a lot of white people in the South who got fired or even killed for, you know, fighting racial prejudice. But in my time, I don't know anybody else that, I don't know any other white person that got fired for fighting racial prejudice. And I told this story before, so I won't go into big detail about it, but I went to work later on part-time for Menorah Medical Center, and I worked, I think, 2 or 3 days a week. I can't remember. It was part-time because I needed money to pay the Internal Revenue Service. For years, I'd been divorced for forever, and I had, from the very beginning, I took the tax deductions for the kids, 4 kids. And when my ex-wife moved in with her mother, when tax time came around, I called and asked if, because the ex-wife and the kids were living with her, if she was going to take the kids as a deduction. And she said no, that she wasn't. So I went ahead like I had been for years and years, and for 2 years I filed, you know, claiming my 4 kids, and then I got audited. And she had claimed, and two, she was perfectly entitled to, because, you know, they were living with her. She was paying more. You know, I could have contested it, but I was giving X amount of money each month for child support, but she had a house and electric and things that she could, you know. So if I'd just known, then I would have, but, so I got audited, and I think I owed $3,000, so I had to work about a year part-time in order to make that money, in order to pay that. And oh, okay, I forgot where I was going again. So I just went in on midnight shift, just did my time there at Menorah Medical Center. There was the second shift. I worked midnights, the third shift. The second shift supervisor was a young black lady, and she seemed competent and seemed to, but I would come in, and so there'd be a little bit, the second shift would be there, third shift would come in and be a little bit, and then they'd go and we'd be there. And I would come in, and occasionally she'd make some statement that just showed that, you know, she saw an old white man, and she just thought, I didn't come in and she didn't say, "Jim, you're racist." But she would come in, I would come in, and she would say something, and I never answered her back or anything. I just ignored it. And I can't remember the type of thing she would say. It would be, you know, I'd come in and say something, and she'd say, "Why does it matter?" You know, like, I can't think of what I said, but I'll make something up, you know. I'd come in and say, "Who's working with me tonight?" And she'd say, "Why does it matter if they're black?" So, and that's not actually something I think, but because I can't remember what it was. And so, you know, that went on, and I just ignored it because I had just came in to work my shift, get my money, and I was I came in this one night, and black security officer came in, and I had hired him in when I worked at Trinity Lutheran Hospital. And I'm not going to go on the entire story, but he was black. I hired him in, and he was going to the second shift where I had problem with them being racially prejudiced, where I had talked to them individually and where I had ended up getting one of them fired. You know, I had talked to him and told him, "Chuck, you know, straighten up. Don't use this type of language. Don't do this type of stuff." And he persisted in doing it. So I had a confrontation with him over that. He told me, because for a while for 3 months I was in charge of all three shifts because the lieutenant had a heart attack. And so he was on the second shift, I was working the day shift. I was a sergeant on the day shift. The lieutenant had come back from his heart attack and was back, just came back. And the lieutenant who had the heart attack, the guys on the second shift, let's call it the racist shift, the stuff they did was unbelievable. He'd had a heart attack and they were calling him, I'm sure, at home, telling him, "Hey, Jim's going to take your job over," and no telling what they told him, which was not the truth. So he came back, and so anyway, I won't go into the. I had to talk to Chuck. I had to tell him to move his truck. And what he had done is he deliberately came into work. Employees were not supposed to park on the first four levels. He parked on the first level. Not only did he, and I wouldn't have cared. It was second shift. Most everybody's gone out of the parking garage. It was not, it was a rule. You weren't supposed to park on the first four levels if you were an employee. I really wouldn't care. Who fucking cared, you know, really? But he came in and then he deliberately parked his big truck with a camper thing on the back. And there was almost no cars on the first level, right in front of the gates. And we had a shack over here with the parking lot attendant was in. I was in charge of seven parking lot attendants too. And the parking lot attendant, then from where he was, he had, you know, buttons he could raise the gates up, and he couldn't see the gates. And so the parking lot attendant said, "Chuck, could you do me a favor? Just move your truck over a little bit. You know, fuck you." And he went on in. So they... parking lot attendant contacted me, and then I called Chuck, said, "Chuck, you need to move your truck." So then Chuck came down, and then Chuck came over to me, and he said, "Jim, I don't know why you care more for those people than you do for your own kind." And I said, "Chuck, I told you I didn't want to hear that stuff out of you. There's nothing you can do. You're not the supervisor on the second shift anymore." And then he walked off. So I... went upstairs to the lieutenant, where the lieutenant was upstairs, told Manuel what had happened, said, "Manuel, he needs to be fired." "Nope, not going to fire him. You're not in charge of that shift." By the way, Manuel was, I don't know, I guess, of Mexican ancestry or whatever. And I'm sure those guys, talked about him, or they didn't, you know, I mean, they were, but they had him conned, or, so anyway, I went down to personnel, human resources department, went in, the director of personnel was not there, because the assistant director, I went in and said, you know, "Chuck," whatever his name was, "needs to be fired," and the assistant, a lady, the assistant director of the department, said, "Oh, Jim, it'll have to wait till Mr. Vernon Johnson comes back from Florida. He's at a seminar down there. He'll be back in a few days." And I said, "No, Chuck needs to be fired. He needs to be fired right now. You're the assistant director of this department. Are you going to fire him or not?" And she said, "No, it has to wait till Mr." And I said, "Okay." So I went over to the administrative wing and went to the assistant administrator of the hospital, went in and said, "Here's what happened. Chuck needs to be fired." And he said, he is fired. And he picked up the phone, called upstairs to the lieutenant, Manuel, and said, "You know, Chuck is fired. Collect the keys and badge and whatever, and he's out. He's fired." So I stepped out the door, got in the elevator, went up to the sixth floor, and Manuel's getting his coat on. "I gotta go. I have a dentist appointment. I forgot all about it. I gotta go." And he was out the door. The lieutenant shared the office with the secretary, department secretary. She said, "Jim, he has me make his dental appointments and remind him, and he doesn't have it." I said, "I know that." So Chuck came in or whatever, and I said, "Chuck, you're fired. Turn in your, you know." "I want to talk to Mr. Ross." That was the director of the department. I said, "He's in the hospital as a patient. You can't talk to him." "Oh, I want to talk to Manuel." I said, "Manuel had a dentist appointment. He left. You're fired." I want to talk to Mr. Johnson." And I said, you'll be able to talk to him in a few days. You're fired, though, but turn it, because he's not here. He's in Florida. Turn in your stuff." Chuck turned in his stuff. So anyway, I worked for 30 years. None of the hospitals I worked for were for profit. And then I retired. I mean, I didn't retire after I got fired. I continued, you know, worked hospitals. But then in 2000, after the 2000 census, I went down to, and at first I wasn't going to work because I was retired. And then I got down there, I thought, I'll get me a job. From contract security company, and I'll just sit there in a desk inside a lobby and check people in and out. A lot different than what I'm doing now. And I went to this company, United States Security. I can't remember because I worked for two different part-time, for two different, one was U.S. Security and one was United States Security. Forget which one this was, and I went there and said, "I'm just looking for a job, sitting inside a lobby someplace, checking people in and out." And they said, "Oh my God, 30 years hospital security, we've got an account, a hospital account, the Osceola Regional Medical Center. You're going to be in charge of that security account or whatever." And I said, "No, I don't want to." And they said, "Oh, we need you. This place has had gone through several different security contract places. They've had terrible problems with all of them. And we need somebody to go out and fix things." And I said, "It can't be done. When something happens like that and something doesn't work out, those people will never forget it. And they're going to, you know, remember those other companies. You can't undo. It can't be undone." And so anyway, "Oh yeah, you can do it." So then the lieutenant or the captain or whatever, "I'll run you out there. You got to meet the guy who's in charge of the maintenance department. He's the one that's going to be, you're going to be reporting to. He's over you out there." And then the guy has my personnel file there. And he, "Wow. No arrests, no convictions." And I, you know, he said, I've never seen one of these, you know, never seen one of these before." And I thought, "My God, who are you hiring?" So they run me out there, and my God. they had to go through, I had to go through the new employee orientation. I wasn't exactly an employee. I was a contract employee. You know, I was in charge of the security thing. Of course, I still worked out there, but had to go through the week of employee with the other, you know, with the nurses and the lab people and x-ray, who was being hired in. Had to go through the thing for a week. One entire day of that was required by the federal government, because it wasn't just this hospital, but it was the health HCA or whatever they were, had been found guilty of massive Medicare and Medicare, Medicaid, all of them, fraud. They were fined a ton of money, and I don't think anybody went to jail. The guy who ran the place, who is now the governor of Florida, Republican governor of Florida, got a nice package of money to leave the company. But all employees of this hospital and other hospitals, but of this hospital, had to go through one day of being told what crimes the Health Corporation of America had done, and what to do if we saw any of the following Medicaid, Medicare fraud or violations of regulations happen, who we would report them to. So I'm in this new employee orientation, and I said, okay, well, you know, what was it? We're going to have to get you all certified on CPR, and it was a few nurses that said, my CPR card is up to date. And then, you know, they said, well, you know, all the rest of you will have to, we'll have to get you, you have to be CPR certified. And the security guard there, we're going to have to get you CPR certified too. And I said, well, I'm already certified. I'm a CPR, I'm a CPR instructor. And then it was several times too during the, you know, something would come up and I'd say, you know, I'm already taken care of in that area. So then I went to work for these people, and I don't know how other for-profit hospitals are, but this place, remember the story you may have heard about an accident happened, car accident or something happened, and they made a movie about it. I mean, I'm beginning this all correct. Two girls, one killed, the other one seriously messed up. And parents show up at the hospital, and the parents are told, well, your daughter died. So the parents take, you know, get the body released and have a funeral. And then the girl who wasn't killed, you know, the parents are there with her. She has to go through surgery and not able to communicate for days or weeks or whatever, and the family is there by the side. And then finally, they find out. The people who were there with their daughter, that wasn't their daughter. Their daughter was the one that was killed. And the people who had the funeral for the daughter, their daughter was in the hospital, and that funeral that they had for who they thought was that was these people. While I was there, I could not believe the way this place operated. Usually, at night and on weekends or whatever, you know, the nursing supervisor is in charge of the hospital when the hospital administrator is not there. And at other hospitals, especially larger hospitals, well, of course, this was a large hospital too, but especially at, they're really, because I'm thinking back about this incident with the nurse and the detective, but the nursing supervisors are really usually pretty sharp. And I always work really well with them. The one or two, and well, I remember one supervisor that I saw, totally incompetent. And then the nurse that was in charge of the head nurse that was in charge of the emergency room, she was in charge, I think that she was not just in charge of the day shift, I think she was in charge of the other two shifts, I think. I know at least she was in charge of the day shift. I can't believe she was actually a nurse. Unbelievable. One example. Of course, by the way, this hospital had had several contract security companies before. They had one, and I'm not sure exactly which order they had this happen in, and maybe it happened on a couple things. They started out and they had, I don't know, two or three security officers on each shift, and they had problems with the security company. They got rid of the security company. They got a new, and they had less security officers on. You know, they had problems with that. They had ended up, by the time I took over, there was one security officer on each shift, and you were not allowed to go in the hospital. You had to stay out in the parking lot until they needed you. When they needed you, you know, you went in. But when they didn't need you, you couldn't. Of course, you could go in. You had to go in and punch in when you got there and get the keys. Every other person who worked there, by the way, had ID. Your ID, they kept there in the office. So when you went in, well, you couldn't even get into the office. You had to knock on the door and let the plant ops guy let you in so you could go into your little office so you could get the keys and then so you could get your ID card. And now you could go in to go to the bathroom because they didn't have a bathroom outside. I guess it didn't. It's a wonder they didn't put a porta potty out there for us. And you could go in to have lunch. You could go in if you needed to get some, you know, a form or something. But so anyway, I'm working there, and they had it arranged so ambulances come up to one side of the ER, and they had a code to get in. But other people, you know, you couldn't just drive up with your grandma and go in that door. You had to come around a corner to it, you know, that leads you into the waiting room. Guy pulls in. I went over to see if I could help, you know. Get a wheelchair. I got a wheelchair. And anyway, he says, you know, my mother's having chest pain. He didn't say diaphoretic, but she was sweating, you know. She was sweating, chest pain, numbness in her arm. Every symptom of having a heart attack. And so I took her on in. So you go in, and the way they have the check-in procedure at the emergency room is, you go up to the glass window. They have a glass windows, two or three people there, clerks, you know, to sign people in. Now, actually, they don't sign you, you know. You go in, and then there's a glass window, and there's a nurse in there who's taking care of stuff on the other side, doing stuff. But there is a nurse in there. But you go up to a window, and it's like one of these windows where the thing opens up, the plastic, heavy-duty plastic. And there's a clipboard in there. And then you write, so I have this, well, anyway, not this one, but you have, let's say, you have this, well, I had a guy that I ran, let me take him first. Had a guy that Well, now let's go back to this. What you do is you come in and you take the clipboard and you write down name, type of problem, bleeding, severe bleeding, arterial bleeding, you know, whatever. I don't care what you, and you put it in there. And then you're supposed to go sit down. Of course, when I brought a couple of these, I stood there and just looked at the nurse. And so finally, they go, oh, okay. Have them check in over at the window over there. So anyway, I go out. This guy comes with his mother all the time. By the way, I was a CPR instructor and an EMT, by the way. Not an EMT in Florida, but I was an EMT in Missouri. Which I never told anybody. Well, I did tell the thing in the... maybe I also mentioned... there wouldn't have been anything we'd come up in the thing. So anyway, I bring the lady in, and I know, you know, that... So I go over to the window where the women are back there. And now, I had a code and a key. Or was it just a code? I could have gone over to the ER door and just punched in the code, but I knew. So I just go over, and I said, this lady's having chest pain. And she said, I'll press the button. So she pushed the button. I took her on back, and there was that head nurse or whatever. Why'd you bring her back here? And I said, well, she's having, you know, of course, as soon as I went, she's having chest pain, numbness in her, you know, whatever. Why'd you bring her back here? And then she took her, you know. So I'm outside, and not very long later, she comes out. The smoking area was out there, so she was out there smoking. And I went over, and she says, don't ever do that again. And I said, do what again? Don't ever bring anybody back in the ER. Just put the, go to the thing, fill out the thing, and put it in there, and that they'll take care of it. And so... to show you the way this thing. I'm making my rounds there outside the hospital. I go over into the medical building. There's nobody in the medical. It's unlocked. It hadn't been locked up yet by me because it's not about time to be locked up. And there's a guy just standing in the lobby. So, you know, I didn't know whether he had come, the doctor was going to meet him at his office, or if maybe his wife worked there in the building or whatever. But I go over and, sir, can I help you? And he said, no, I'm okay. I said, are you sure? Anything I can do for you? Well, I'm just waiting for my doctor. And I said, oh, your doctor's going to meet you here? Yeah, he's going to cut my head off. I said, oh. I said, going to cut your head off? Yeah, he's going to cut my head off. I said, you know, they wouldn't do that here. I said, I think I need to take you over to the emergency room. That's where they would do it. I said, just come with me. So I took the radio, and the radio system, oh my God. You may remember the name of the cell phone / intercom. It was actually pretty neat at the time. It was a cell phone, but it was also the people who were in the system. You could go talk to them radio to radio, you know, without having to actually dial it or whatever. You keyed it up or something. And so the head nurse, and they had their supervisors. They were required, well, of course, they had, at work they had them, like the head nurse had one, I had one. The head nurse in the emergency room had one. Switchboard operator had one. But, so anyway, I call the head nurse in the emergency room, who wasn't this lady. It was, might have been second shift or something. I called and I said, I'm bringing over a gentleman who's here. He says the doctor is supposed to cut his head off. I found him in the lobby of the medical building, and I'm bringing him over to the emergency room. So I go over to the emergency room. Nothing has changed. You know, there's patients there. The clerks are doing their thing. There's the window, the nurse or whatever at the triage nurse or whatever is inside there, I don't know, counting the syringes or doing whatever they do. And so I'm standing there with this guy at the thing. So I open up the plastic thing, plexiglass thing, and I take the clipboard. I say, "Sir, what is your name?" "John Doe." "Okay. And you're here to have your head cut off, yeah?" "Here to have his head cut off." Then whatever else they wanted on there. And I drop it in there. And I wait. And I wait. I forget how long I've waited. Then finally the guy comes over. Okay. And then I forget what, I don't think they took him in right, Whatever, so I eventually went outside. I noticed it, well, on this place, you would not believe their lost and found system. I'm not going to go through it with you, but just let me, it's the worst lost and found system. If you try to find somebody's glasses or somebody's shoes, whatever it is, well, I'm going to tell you a little bit. The person comes into the emergency room. "Do you have any valuables?" "Yes." "Okay." So the emergency room takes the valuables. They lock them up in a drawer there or something. So, you know, if you're going to be going home or whatever, okay, you're valuable. You know, if you don't forget, okay, here's your valuable. You leave, okay. If you have to go, if you're admitted to the hospital, you go upstairs to a room. Okay, your valuables. Now, if it's money or a diamond ring or something, they should call admitting or something, and they come in. Take it up. If it's other stuff, you know, it might seem that it's not valuable to, you know, that it's not diamonds or gold or whatever, but it still may be something that's of value to somebody. So your stuff may stay there. You go upstairs and your stuff, the nurse didn't know you had it, they changed shifts or whatever. So you go up to your room, and you're in your room. Now, maybe your valuables go up with you. Maybe they go to your room. Maybe they don't. You go up to your room. Okay, they decide you need to go to surgery, or it could be you need to go to the intensive care unit. But say you need to go to surgery. So you go to surgery. So you go to surgery. Now, when you leave surgery, you don't go back to the same room. You're going to go to post-surgery or something, wing, room, whatever. So you go. Maybe your valuables end up going with you. They're probably either, are they back at the room that you were in? Did they still, you know? So you go to your room after surgery. Okay. Maybe you go home. Do you get your valuables? Are they still there? You're in your room. You don't go home. You take a sudden turn for the worse. They move you to the intensive care unit. Did your valuables go with you? They should. Did they? Who knows? Okay, you're better. You go back to a room, but you don't go back to the, you know, you go back to another room. You get the idea? I forget. I had a couple items I had to try to track down. At the Trinity Lutheran Hospital or whatever, we took care of patient valuables. I helped set up the system for patient valuables. So I went, and the lady who was the secretary for the maintenance department, and the maintenance guy was over me, which of course rubbed me the wrong way. I mean, I was used to a place where there was a director of security, not director of maintenance, you know. But, so I go to her and I say, you know, the lost and found procedure that you have here, it has some, you know. I think she must have been a kindergarten teacher in the past, or maybe a first grade teacher, because she said, Jim, now Jim, our plan, the plan that we have was approved by the Joint Commission inspection people. They came and they approved it. Yeah, Jim, oh, shit. Joint Commission, I don't know how long she'd worked there, but I worked for hospitals for 30 years. I know how the Joint Commission works when they do their inspections. They don't do their inspections every year. They do it every 2 or 3 years, I think. But I saw a lot of them. I know how they worked. I know what they checked. I'll bet you they never came and looked. Now, they could have. They never came and looked at this lost and found. You know, they have a doctor on the commission. They have maybe a couple of nurses, and then there'll be somebody else on the commission that comes, because every time they do these inspections, they can't cover everything with a hospital. So there'll be maybe somebody from medical records is on the commission that's doing the thing, or maybe there's somebody on there from, I never ever saw anybody from security, but whatever it is, and that's something they go into. Now, what they do go into are some things like medical records, not lost and found procedures. And they, you know, go into, you know, fire, that type of thing, which falls in the area of security. But anyway, she talked to me like, you know, and that procedure was so. So then I'm out, of course, in the parking lot, because that's the only place I'm allowed to be. I'm out in the parking lot, and for days, I see them doing construction, you know, painting an area out there. And they're moving their helicopter pad. Of course, nobody says anything to me. I'm out there, and they paint the helicopter landing pad, and they put up some lights, and they put up some signs. Damage, possible damage to your car. Oh, they put up the lights, you know, like going out with the signs, and you know that's parking here, because parking is always, you know, cars are parked there and everything. So finally, one of the maintenance guys comes out. He's standing out there. I said, "I see you're moving your helicopter landing pad." Yeah. And we got these lights up, and we put the red lights there and whatever. Because the helicopter will come right in, and we had to put these signs here because of the blades kick up, you know, rock, and it might damage these people's cars if they're parked in the first. And I said, you do realize that the helicopter will come in based on the direction that the wind is blowing. They're not going to come right up the path that you made for them with these lights. They may, but if the wind is blowing a certain way, they're going to come in. Oh no! They'll come up that way, and do that. And of course, I didn't say. I didn't say anything, you know. I didn't say I fucking worked at one hospital that had a helicopter stationed there, and when I was there for hundreds of takeoffs of the helicopter. I had to go out there. If I was in that assigned to that area, I had to go out there and block everything off. And I was there for hundreds of landings of the helicopter. I worked at another hospital that we had, a small hospital. We had the helicopter come out there once or twice a week. And I was there for the landing. Well, if I was, we didn't have security there around the clock, but if I was, it was night and I was there. I was there for that. I just wish I had never worked there. Because then my experience would all be 30 years hospital security, treated like a professional, But now, this reason I got this out is I'm trying to go through and put down dates and times and put it all someplace and then be able to get rid of a bunch of this crap, because I have a whole bunch of, I have a files filled with stuff like this. I want to put it down so I have it someplace that I can get rid of this stuff. If I was going to be working in the future, then I would keep the certificates or whatever, just pull it out, throw it into a folder or something or other. Do I want to even know how long I've been doing this, how long I've been talking? God, I don't think I do. How long is it going to take this? And this isn't even going to be a 4K video. Oh, yeah, wait a minute. I made a walking and talking short video the other day. Wonder how this is going to me. This is it. It's very short.
Well, I'm going to the mailbox here in the apartment complex. This is my Panasonic LX7 camera. I haven't used it in a while. It's been a while since I've made a walking and talking video. Not sure I'll even post this, but I'd fire up this old camera. I wouldn't mind having the LX10, but I don't want to spend that kind of money, because I want to get a much bigger and better, more powerful camera. And of course, when I say bigger, it's actually going to be bigger, but the LX7 is a point-and-shoot pocket-sized camera, so I'll bring this to a conclusion.
Okay. Thank you very much for watching this long video. Why do I do this?